I'm here at the scene of tomorrow's shooting, where a 15-year-old will kill four children, two adults, and then turn the gun on himself.
When the shooting starts happening tomorrow, first I'll probably just think it's firecrackers or a car backfiring or something.
He told some of us that his dad kept a gun in his closet, and he always talked about using it on, you know, the people that bullied him. Tomorrow I'll probably say that I wish I told someone.
You know, after the shooting, we're gonna feel pretty bad about picking on him, but until then, we'll probably just keep doing it because he's pretty weird.
Tomorrow I'll probably point out that something has seemed off with him since the beginning of the school year.
And I'm now joined by the officers who will be the first responders tomorrow. What additional details can you share with us?
Well, someone is expected to tell us after the shooting that the shooter has been posting on social media about doing this for weeks.
So how will you explain the shooting to your daughter?
Actually, I won't get to explain it to her because she won't make it.
This is Christine Lynn, reporting from the scene of another shooting. We'll say we never saw coming.
What up, everybody? Kevin Jackson here. If you feel the need and you want to get in touch with the hot topics from today's headlines, you got to check out The Booth with Keith, Sinister One Hayes. Tell him Kevin Jackson sent you.
I'm here at the scene of tomorrow's shooting, where a 15-year-old will kill...
What up, everybody? Kevin Jackson here. If you feel the need and you want to get in touch with the hot topics from today's headlines, you got to check out The Booth with Keith, Sinister One Hayes. Tell him Kevin Jackson sent you.
All right, what's up? It's your boy Sinister One here from The Booth. I'm here with the man, wide receiver Julian Edelman. And this is a guy that, you know, people say, oh, he's the West Walt Capone. He's this, he's that. To me, he's Julian Edelman. He made a name for himself. And this year is going to be step up here because my feeling is West Walt is going to do a lot of rehab. You're going to be that guy. Are you ready to step it up and be that guy that they're going to be looking forward to?
Well, I hate the word step up because...
You step it up all the time.
Yeah, that's that's what I think you should do as a professional athlete and playing at this level. You should always be stepping up. I mean, anytime your number's called, you just got to go in there and you got to do what you got to do. You know, I'm not going to step up this year. I'm just going to do what I did last year, prepare myself to the best of my ability and... hopefully go from there.
And I want to give you big props because you stayed out here. You're the last guy out here signing autographs. Kids are still waiting for you. And like we said, this season's coming up right out the gate. You got an AFC matchup, and then you got three divisional matchups right off the bat. I mean, the taste in your mouth is going to be ready, all ready for this season.
Hey, you know, I'm hungry for all that, but first you got training camp. You got to get through that.
And two-a-days.
Two-a-days. And so I'm looking forward to that. You know, I got to work on a lot of things this off season. I still got to learn the position of receiver, and you know, it's going to take a lot of work and preparation, and you know, I'm looking forward to that in training camp.
And one last question, how's it feel to be heading into training camp and not being a rookie and starting cars for people this year?
It feels good, but all these guys hassle you and say game three, that's when you're not a rookie, so I guess I'm still a rookie to these guys, so, you know.
All right, Julian,
see what it is.
Thanks, man.
Hey, no problem, man.
Good luck this season.
Take it easy.
Can you dig it? Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
This is blasphemy. This is madness. This is The Booth.
Your boy Sinister One broadcasting live from the City of Champions. You will listen to The Booth, and I've actually trimmed down my intro there. Getting a lot of sponsors, getting a lot of stuff going on, and I want to be able to get ready to meet the tailors of the show. And we've got a lot of people in the chat, and I've got a special guest on here. But before I mention my special guest, I got to give a big thanks to last week's special guest, Will Tarashuk, for coming on the show. Ambiguous Podcast Solutions. He was on with me last week. We had a great show. Check out the podcast on YouTube.
But tonight I'm joined by two guests. In the second half hour, I've got CEO Michael Polvere of Cape Titans Fighting Championships. They've got a big event coming up, their 50th event. But we've also got our city councilor at large debate tonight at 8 o'clock. So I got a guy, you know, thanks for coming on here. Kind of planned this a week out. Now we've got this debate, so I want to make sure we get this interview in. Mr. Michael Nunes is on the show with us tonight. He's a candidate for councilor at large. And the debate is tonight, 8 o'clock. Michael, please introduce yourself. Let people know who you are and why you're running.
Yeah, well, first and foremost, thank you for having me on your show, Mr. Hayes. I appreciate it. I want to thank you for that. Also, you know, my name is Michael Nunes, obviously, as you just said. I'm running because as a 30-year-old resident, born and raised in Brockton, I don't plan on moving up the city anytime soon. I actually see myself retiring in the city of Brockton, City of Champions. So in order for me to be comfortable and retire in City Champions, I got to make it livable, not just for me, but for all the other residents. Like I tell everyone all the time, we have to work together to make a better community for everyone. And that's why I'm really running, because I think I'm a strong candidate with my background, you know, helping people with my mindset, you know, knowing the history of the city and how we prospered to be what we are today. I think I'm a strong candidate.
Nice, nice, nice. So we're going to get into the news booth, because I've got some questions in the news booth that I want to bring to you as a city council. I know you've got this debate that we want to get to. But first of all, I got to mention that the booth is now seen on two more networks, DLive and the Vaughn Live networks. So now we're out there streaming to these guys. Also, big shout out to Paul Forrest, a big fan of the show. Paul Forrest suffered a heart issue and had to have a bypass, a big triple bypass. He was at Beth Israel Hospital. He's headed off to rehab. He is a big super fan of the show. He's been following the show from day one. So I want to give prayers, blessings, healing prayers to Paul Forrest, man. Everybody here, Bianchi, everybody here is hoping that things go well. Michael Douglas Barreto is one of my sponsors of the show. You need a controller fix for your Xbox, your PlayStation. Send it out to him within 24 hours. He's got you back to gaming. The same problem pops up on your controller. You send it out. It's a lifetime warranty. I'm a huge gamer. Everybody knows that. Also, my recording artist, Fiona Marie. She's on all streaming sites everywhere. Make sure to check her music out. Tactical Target Systems. As you guys know, I'm in fear of the zombie apocalypse. When I go down to the range, I want to practice and get myself ready for the zombie apocalypse. So Tactical Target Systems is where I get my zombie targets, as you see. RebelRom.com, that's my cousin's clothing line. Check out her website for clothing there. And as you guys saw, veteran home Kyle Bunnell's Old Colony Pest Control. Give him a call if you got pest control problems. Like I said, we'd like to support our veterans here. Now let's get into the news booth. This is Mr. Michael Nunes. I got some questions for you coming up right now. Before I get into this, 2021 Aftermath. You can talk about this if you know a little bit about it. Aftermath is a company that does our trauma and cleanup and crime scene cleanup. What they did is they put together this grant for $25,000, a canine grant. Brockton is part of this contest. Tonight is the last night to vote. I know there were a lot of people upset, which I thought was kind of stupid, because we had added several canine dogs to the unit. We're up to four, maybe five canine units on the police force right now. We actually had two dogs go deceased. And I think that the canine dogs, canine units, are a plus for this city. So your thoughts on this, and I want to make sure everybody gets out there, heads over to the Aftermath site and fill out the real quick. Can you speak on the canine units?
Yeah, I'm with you. I agree. And I actually voted for one of those canines. I forgot which one it was, but I believe we have more than one to vote, right?
Yes.
Gentlemen. Okay, yeah. So I don't remember which one I voted, but I agree.
Kilo.
We should have canines.
Kilo.
Kilo. That's the one. That's the one. Yeah, Kilo. Yep. But I voted for him, but... Go ahead.
Go ahead. I want you to explain the importance of the canine dogs in this area and what they bring to the people.
Yeah, of course. For criminals especially, I'm pretty sure a criminal would rather get bitten by a dog than shot by a bullet. Am I correct? Right? So if we have more dogs to patrol with these police officers and they got to use that as their first tactical aggression method, that'd be better off than firing a bullet, you know. It's sad. You know, and obviously we don't want the dogs to get hurt, you know, when they go out attacking these criminals, but most criminals know if you attack the dogs, it's like you're attacking officers. So usually they don't attack the dogs. So I think, you know, the canine's way better than obviously than using the guns as a first response method. but obviously it comes to the budget. Can we afford to get more dogs? Can we afford, you know, you gotta feed these dogs, you gotta take care of them, you gotta, you know, nurture them, and just like having a pet.
And the dog is a partner. People don't realize that. When the dog becomes with an officer, that's his partner. They bring the dog home, you know, they live with the dog. The dog is, you know, in the kennel, but, you know, they do build that relationship. So that's good to see. So, guys, it's the last night. Please vote 2021 Aftermath K9 Grant. $25,000 will be determined if Brockton wins. Kilo will be able to get the secret kennel, all types of stuff. It's a good look. We need it. And I don't hear or see any music in the background. Where are you guys?
PremiumBeat.com.
Not seeing anything. Hopefully it's up. Somebody says music is too loud. A lot of people. Okay. Yeah, okay. No, everybody's in the chat. People are saying they can hear me. They said spooky music is playing in the background.
Oh, that's probably drop image.
Oh, my background. My background is probably playing some type of spooky music, and let me get rid of that. But they can hear us. Okay, good. All right, thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Also, let's get into this meat of this topic right now. Brockton High, 712. Yep, I shut it off, guys. Brockton High has had some issues, and it's not just Brockton High. It's a lot of places across the country is seeing this problem. Now, what pisses me off about this is that people are saying that it's because the kids were cooped up for a year under COVID and they're having a hard time. No, stop it. Stop it. People know how to act when they get their asses in school. I'm tired of hearing that cop out. Now, the principal has been replaced. Metal detectors have been added. No more backpacks, but something had to be done. And here's the thing. This was building from day one at Brockton High. We saw this. Oh, Michael, where'd you go? This was building This was building from day one at Brockton High. We seen it. We saw the stories. And one of the first things we saw was a lot of kids sharing social media of things that were going on in the school. And it was pissing me off because I'm like, okay, I'm a parent. My kids are out of high school, but I did know to check my kid's social. If my kid has a social media account, I'm checking his account. I've got his passwords. I'm making sure that my kid's not doing licks and stealing sinks out of the school. I'm making sure that my kid's not doing this and not doing that. That's the big problem with a lot of these kids today, that's hard for some of these teachers, because a lot of parents, let's be real, they ain't parenting no more. A lot of parents aren't parenting no more. A lot of parents are friends before being parents. When kids got in trouble in school, parents would show up. Your kid would get in trouble. You go home and you got your ass whooped. Now parents come to the school and they want to defend their kid 100,000 times when their kid is one of the worst kids in the school. So my feeling is we need people to step up and just start parenting their kids. Your thoughts on that? Because I feel like that's one of the parts of Brockton High's problem is people don't want to parent.
Yeah, it starts at home, like everyone knows that. It starts at home, you know? And that excuse, like you said, is not an excuse that they can use COVID, whatever, so they've been stuck at home for a year. If that was the case, they should have been more obedient because you had a whole year to make them a parent them. So that it was at home, you should know how they act exactly. So we got to stop with the excuses. We got to stop with the crying. Listen, I'm going to say exactly how it is. People are like, oh, we don't want our schools to look like prisons. Well, I don't want my school to look like a morgue either. So that's it's right. Either or. We need metal detectors. The principal that came from the champion school, great for her. She's doing a great job, and she's proven. Day one, she's proven herself. And I'm proud of her because, you know, I went to Brockton High. I know how it was. I'm not going to sit here and say I was a good kid. I got myself in trouble. And guess what? Like you said, when I went home, I got my ass whipped. You know, that's how it is. I got handled. And what it is, too, these parents, I don't know what it is, but they're scared. I think they're scared, like a knock in their head or something. That's not going to get no, that's not child abuse. They really got to see what child abuse is, you know. Burning the kid's hand on the oven is child abuse.
That's right.
Knocking him across the head is not child abuse. You know, there's a limit. And people are afraid of parent. Like you said, they're afraid of parent. But it starts at home before they go to school.
And people don't realize this, but if you were to call DCF, corporal punishment is allowed. You can spank your kid. A lot of people think, oh, I can't spank my kid. Yes, you can. You can still spank your kid.
Especially the Cape Verdean culture, immigrants that come, they're scared. a lot of them, you know, they're scared because they're probably scared their kids might just call themselves, you know, or go to school and complain that their parents hit them. Then you got DSS at your house and all that stuff, you know.
Wow, yeah, it's crazy stuff. But again, you know, they're doing the right thing. They've replaced the principal. The principal from the champion school is now at Brockton High School. Hopefully, I wish her a lot of luck. But again, she needs help from the parents. That's first and foremost. I see people on Facebook. I see people talking about all this stuff. And I'm like, first and foremost, stop acting up. If you know your kid is on social media, like this whole incident that brought the lockdown, the young man had took a picture with a magazine clip in his pants, and then he posted it to TikTok. He's a young kid. His parents should be monitoring his social media. If his parents were monitoring his social media, that post of him with that magazine clip would have never been reported. It would have been pulled down over the weekend, and his ass would have been whooped if that was my kid. What are you doing? What are you thinking? And that's where I say, yeah. You know, that it just, and it's not even just the violent stuff. It's the sexual stuff. It's the young girls on TikTok. It's the young girls. And now you've got some of these young mothers with their young daughters on these TikToks. It's just sheer craziness. So I gotta really commend you on that one, because that is going to be a big problem for anybody who gets in. Any of the city councilors, whoever ends up getting voted in, this Brockton High issue for me, I feel like it isn't going away.
No, the problem with these councilors is they're afraid to speak the truth. They want to pander for votes. I'm not here to pander. I'm telling you how it is. You don't like it, too bad. You like it, vote for me. That's how it is. You know, I'm not going to pander for nobody. I'm going to say how it is. These parents got to parent their kids more better. Now, all these other students are suffering. 2-hour wait. I don't agree with the 2-hour wait line. Of course not. But sometimes you have to do what you have to do to make the safe environment. And now that statement is sent to all these parents to see that 2-hour wait. Now you're going to go and parent your kids better so that 2-hour wait won't happen no more.
That's right. And moving on, because I know you got to get out of here to get to this debate. Let's get into this last topic. Ending homelessness in Brockton. Old hotel sees new life as apartments for homeless. So if you guys didn't hear the story, FatherBills Mainspring House has purchased the Roadway Inn, and they've also purchased the old National Guard building behind the VA, which is now going to take up some of that homeless congestion over by FatherBills Mainspring House and bring some of those people over there to provide them with adequate housing for their, you know, for those family situations. I get it. I love it. I hate homelessness. But the problem with homelessness is that you house them, you get them off the streets during the night, but then in the daytime, you unleash these people back onto the streets, and then you end up with places like Needle Park, or you end up with places like Methadone Mile. I know those people in that ward over there by the Roadway Inn and over behind the VA. They're not going to want that mess and that foolishness over in that side of town over there. And I get it, because, you know, I work with Paul Revere. Paul Revere Transportation has a facility that's located over on Mass Ave that was once a Best Western hotel, that round building. Guess what happened? COVID hit. Best Western went out of business. They sold that building to the Pine Street Inn. The Pine Street Inn opened up to homeless people. And what ended up happening? It just dumped 1,000 more people on Methadone Mile to where it's a friggin' epidemic right now. We don't want that. We don't want that here in that side of town. Go ahead, sir.
So, yeah, that program that they had there is horrible. That Pine in Boston is horrible. Father Bills, listen, I was against them for a long time for having that Mainspring in downtown. Now, you know, I praise them for what they're doing now, because this is exactly what they're doing. The Roadway Inn is permanent housing. So it's not like, you know, it's housing. So it's actual housing. You go there, you apply, and it's not just for women, because I know a lot of men are homeless, and people understand that. Men, for the programs, is rare for us to get approved for these programs. Father Bill noticed that, and they're helping out a lot. So it's permanent housing at the Roadway Inn, because I went to the meeting in the old National Guard building right there by West Chestnut, across the street from Nissan 24 and all that Paramount flooring. Mm-hmm. That is going to be extended. It's going to be an add-on. They're going to use the old part, and they're going to add on, and it's going to be programs. They're going to have the medical care in there. They're going to have job search. They're going to have everything you can think of. They're going to have the common room, and it's not going to be like in and out. It's the same thing. It's another housing program. So over there, it's 98 beds. Roadway is 100-something. This is way more than enough for then with the homeless we have already. So it's for the homeless we have already plus more, which is kind of like, we're trying to get more. But regardless, they're going to come because they see how Brockton is, homeless central, and they come. But Father Bill's doing a great thing. They're changing it. And they're going to sell that building, the old Mainspring, which was an old commercial club for the prestige people of Brockton, for the rich and elite. You know, they're going to sell that. Brockton, you know, if I win, if I get elected, I will tell Brock, City of Brockton, to purchase that building and make it the new museum. That's my goal with that building.
And you gotta, yeah, you gotta change it. So we're at 7:20. We got a lot of people in the chat. I see John Hayes in the chat. I see my brother in the chat. I see Vianna Marie in the chat. I see a lot of people from Brockton, the City of Brockton, in the chat. Thank you for tuning into the show, Michael. I know you got to get this debate going at 8 o'clock, so I don't want to leave you late. Just tell people how they can follow you and support you, and you know your candidacy.
Yeah, you can follow me on Michael Nunes for Brockton at Councilor at Large, you know, on Facebook. Or you can just go to my website, noonsforbrockton.com. And my contact number is 774-581-1533. You can text me or call me that number. I always answer. And there's one thing I just else want to say. I'm having an event, my final event, October 28th from 7 to 11 p.m. Everybody's welcome to come. I want as much people to show up. I'm going to have a formal speech. I'm going to talk about my candidacy. I'm going to answer the questions for everyone that asks questions. I got the answers for. So, again, that's October 28th from 7 to 11 at the perfect place in Brockton, Massachusetts.
Nice, nice, nice. And you got, I got one question because everybody comes on this show. They know I'm fair. They know I had Gary Keith on 2 weeks ago, who's also in the chat. Gary Keith shared some personal conversation with me. Before we let you get out of here, I got to ask you a question about the Cape Verde community real quick. A while back, we just had an incident in the Cape Verde community where a young man was killed by, as we all would say, he was racist. He had his Nazi armband on. He shot a young Cape Verdean man who played soccer, lost his life. Our prayers and blessings went out to that family. And there was a lot of outrage. There was a lot of people upset about this murder. And I get it. I was upset too. But also, in the Cape Verde community, we've also seen over the many, many years in the City of Brockton, we've seen in the black community too, because I've questioned this in the black community myself. We've seen cases of violence outside of nightclubs and stuff like that. The question that I ask my black people that I got to ask you as you represent the Cape Verde community, why do we not have that same upset crowd when we have killings within our own community? What do we need to do to change that?
Well, I tell you, with the Cape Verde community, we're still, everybody's still close. We're, you know, independence from 1970, small community, everybody's so close. So usually it's kind of odd. But when a Cape Verdean kills a Cape Verdean, they're related by far. So there's not that outrage because you're really not going to be, aunt's not going to be mad at another aunt, or the uncle's not going to be mad at the second uncle, or the third uncle's not going to be mad at the first uncle. They're going to be mad, but what are you going to do? You know, it's family killing family with the Cape Verdeans, and it's embarrassing. You know, obviously I speak. It's not direct. It's not like first cousins, but well, you know, we're still all so close. Anybody with the Nunes, you to ask where I'm from, my parents are from. You know, we're related because they're from the same thing. So it's sad. It's sad. You know,
this is what I'm talking about. This is why I have people on and have to ask the question, because I've never heard that before. I've heard everybody I've heard everybody tiptoe around that question. So please finish.
Yeah. So when you got Ricardo Gomes and, you know, another Gomes, you know, that's killing each other. It happened in the past. I know this myself. Cousins killing second cousins or third. Sometimes they don't even know their family. Third cousin, you know, they're related by the third cousin from this person. So when the aunt named Samantha or whatever her name is can't really yell at the other aunt because their family, like, oh, it's an awkward situation. That's what it comes down to. It's very awkward, you know.
So when you have these cases of these incidents, you have to live with this stigma in your community and within the families where someone may know something, but you just can't because it's a family. That is a crazy dynamic. And
it happens a lot. I'm not saying it happens every time, of course not, but it happens a lot. First of all, it happens way more often than it should. You know, anybody killing anybody.
Wow. I applaud you, man, for coming on because you answered the question that I never heard this answer. Everybody tiptoes around it. And it does explain some of this craziness that we do see, and I respect you. But, sir, again, I want to thank you for coming on this show. I know you got to get out of here. You got to get to this debate, and I wish you luck. A lot of good people running for this councilor seat this year, good people. So, again, let them know how they can follow you and find you.
Yeah, you can contact me, direct number, 774-581-1533. You can visit nunesforbrockton.com, or you can follow me on my Facebook, Michael Nunes for City Councilor at Large, right on Facebook. And again, my event's coming up October 28th at the Perfect Place from 7 to 11 p.m. Hope everybody shows up.
Okay, man. We're going to get ready to get you out of here. I got a lot of people in chat posting stuff. I saw John Hayes posting something about a Mike Stevenson, but I'm not sure what that's all about. Ask him if he was allowed to be disrespectful. Don't know anything about that. But we're going to take a quick break, guys. I got my second guest coming up. It's going to be Michael Polvere, CEO of Cage Titans. And I've got a world premiere video, guys. You guys have been seeing it. It's Happy Halloween. My guys, the Merkins, big fan of the Merkins / Street Boys. They just released a new video for Halloween last night. And this one is their parody of Backstreet Boys. Keep slaying teens in the dark. Enjoy it. We'll be back with more Booth after this.
For 15 years, thank you, Keith. I've been obsessed to find out what was going on inside of him. Scream, choke you with the phone.
All right, it's your boy, Sinister One, broadcasting live from the City of Champions. You are listening to The Booth. I got to thank my last guest for coming on here, Michael Nunes. Michael Nunes, he had to get off because he's got his debate that's coming up. A lot of people in the chat hanging on. My next special guest is on with me, as you guys see over here. This is a familiar face from the MMA community here in Massachusetts. For a while here, we had like three or four promotions. Cage Titans is pretty much the only one around here right now, holding it down. And Mike, man, introduce yourself. Let these people know, man. I could come on here and just be like, yeah, this is a guy I know. Let them know, man. Tell them the whole spiel.
So I got a shout out first, the City of Champions. I don't even know if you know this, but I grew up in Brockton. So I'm also, I actually lived in Pine Estates growing up. I went to Hancock Elementary. My first job was McDonald's on Belmont Street, right across from the high school. I worked there from 14 to 16. My first management job was the Finish Line inside of inside the Westgate Mall.
Yeah, that's going back. Yeah. That's going way back.
Yeah, so it's so funny because I, oddly enough, I remember somebody stole a pair of sneakers out of the Finish Line when I was managing there. And I was a manager in training at the time, and I followed him out to his car, and I got the sneakers back, and I came back, and I showed the manager that I was training under. I was like, oh, I got the sneakers back. This kid was stealing. He's like, what are you doing? We're in Brockton. He's like, you don't do that shit. You don't follow guys. I said, listen, I'm from Brockton. I don't give a shit. I was like, I'll follow the guy to his car. I was like, trust me, I'm good. And so that was a fun story back in, back in my day in Brockton. I played Brockton hockey. I played hockey for Brockton. So I got a little connection with you there. But, yeah, Cage Titans, I mean, we started back in 2010. I was a fighter before this. I mean, growing up, I was always kind of I was never afraid to, like, throw hands, I guess you would say. Growing up in Brockton, you find yourself throwing hands every once in a while. But, I was always an athlete playing sports growing up. And then and I want to say 2007, I found MMA. 2008, somewhere around there, I started fighting. And then my background at the time, I was a marketing sales guy. I was a director of marketing for Mr. Tux, and I was a regional sales manager there. Sorry, man. I was fighting for promotions, and I said, I think I can do this better. You know, I fell in love with MMA, and I saw what other guys were doing, and I thought that I had a better formula. And I thought we could promote fighters better. I thought our marketing could be better than what other shows were doing at the time. I remember when I first fought, I say this a lot of times, you're a little older like I am. And if you remember yellow construction paper, I remember my first fight, I got a Word document printed on that like bright, astro bright construction paper. And that was what the promoter gave me. And I was like, what the F is this? And, you know, some of my fighters nowadays, they're like, what's construction paper? I'm like, you're too young for that. Right, but, right. You know, that was my experience for my first fight promotion that I fought for. So I went home and I made my own fight posters and I got my own pictures and I did it all myself. And then, you know, I realized I was a little later in life. My first fight, I think it was 28. So I knew I wasn't going to really go too far in the sport, but I really enjoyed it. And I thought that I could, help out the MMA community by starting my own promotion. And I worked at Lombardo's in Randolph and I was the operations manager there. And we did a couple shows with a different promoter. And, as the story goes, you know, you hear some horror stories of bad promoters, being kind of shady tactics. And the owners were like, we love doing this MMA event, but we didn't really like that promoter who was here, who bounced checks. He ripped off a couple fighters and did some bad things. And they said, but we think we can do it without him. We have the venue, Mike. You have the background. Let's see what can happen. So in 2010, we got our promoter license and matchmaker license. And here we are 11 years later, and we got Cage Titans 50 coming up next Saturday night.
Unbelievable. And I've been in this Boston area for a long time. I've been following MMA. I've been following UFC, and I've told this story many times. I've been a fan of MMA since UFC 2. I remember sharing Starcase videos of Keith Hackney and guys like Chemo and all these guys that developed what MMA is today. You know, Tank was one of my most favorite guys and thankfully, thank God, I was able to meet Tank in person at a local event one time, and he was like my favorite MMA guy. But then a guy like Dan Severn comes along, who was well-rounded and changed the whole entire sport because he had all of these different genres of mixed martial arts in his repertoire. And it was just nice to see the sport evolve. And here you are doing a Boston first. You're going to host this mega event for your 50th event. You're going to have an event in the daytime, an event in the nighttime. And I know what goes on behind the scenes.
You commentate. You've ring announced.
I need to know, first of all, how did you get the commission to sign off on this, doing two events in one day when they usually used to kind of shy away, number one? Two, and two, how was everybody open to getting their fighters on board for both of these events? I mean, schools must have been right away, yeah, we're going to help this guy out.
Yeah, so it's funny. So on one note, when you talk about going back in the day, I tell this story too. Like my early memories of MMA was watching UFC pay-per-views on my friend's black box in his basement. Yep. And kids nowadays, they're like, what's a black box? I'm like, that's how you used to illegally stream stuff back in the day. Right. So right before COVID, we were scheduled to do April 3rd and April 4th. We were actually going to do back-to-back nights. And then obviously COVID shut everything down. And I've seen that all these fighters have been on the sidelines for the last year and a half when there was no events. So when I came back in July, we pretty much did an almost all pro card because there really wasn't, because there was no fights going on. There was no really avenue for the amateurs. So they kind of stopped training a little bit during COVID, but mm-hmm. the pros were on the sidelines hoping to get to the UFC. Cause like, let's be real, a bunch of the pros need to fight professionally locally to get the experience to move on to the UFC.
Correct.
And then the UFC was the first sport to stop putting shows on during the COVID pandemic. So these pro fighters started training and hoping that they would get a call to the UFC. So when we opened the doors back up in July 10th, we had so many pro fighters ready to go. And my first priority was getting the pros back in action, because a lot of those guys, this is their only job. Like the amateur fighters, you know, some of them have jobs or they're right out of high school or in college and whatever. And, you know, they're doing other things and they're doing fighting to see if they like it. A lot of our professional fighters, this is their job. If they don't fight, they don't get paid. Their goals are to get up to the next level. So they're in a standstill. So our July card was a lot of pros. And then in August, we still had a lot of pros and we started seeing the amateurs come back to the mix. So when this show happened, long-winded, we had a bunch of pros that wanted to fight and I had about 12 pro fights. And I said, well, if I do one event, I don't have any room to put amateurs. I don't want to do a 30 fight card. So I didn't want to shut down the amateurs. And I basically kicked around the idea of doing the day night doubleheader or doing back to back nights like we planned pre COVID. And I got some feedback from the fighters. I got some feedback from the schools and they all were kind of, hey, we like the idea of just going to Plymouth one day, spending the day there, doing a whole day fight festival. The commission, they were a little leery because as you know, they like to only do one event a weekend usually. So not only am I trying to get them to do one, you know, more than one event in a weekend, we're getting them to do one more than one event in one day. The way you package it to them, it's, do you want to do one big event? You know, Keith, you remember the day, CFX days, where they do a fight card with 25, 30 fights.
Mm-hmm. And we're there all day.
And I said, well, we can do one event and I'll do 25 fights in one day, but the commission and all the judges and all the refs and all these people, it gets treated as one event. So they only get paid for one event. I said, I'm giving these guys an opportunity to treat it as two events. So a judge, for instance, a judge gets $250 from the commission to judge. Well, now they're going to do two events and they're going to get $500. For me, I just thought it made a lot of sense for everybody involved. Yes, it's a long day, but they're kind of getting compensated. That was kind of the avenue I took with the athletic commission. I said, if you come down here on Friday and you drive down to Plymouth, all the gas money, the parking in Plymouth to make your money, then go home and then drive and do it all again on Saturday. Why not just drive here once, do it all on the same day, pay to park once, and do that. So It took a little convincing, but here we are. They finally,
And the other argument is if you had a competitor and they had an event scheduled the next night, they would be doing this, driving out to this other event. So it makes sense. It just makes, to me, yeah. I feel like it's a win-win. You know, schools, they have to bring supplies and all this stuff on that day. It's a kind of a no-brainer to have this special double-headed and doing it two nights. I think you really set the tone for something special for this.
Yeah, so, you know, the other thing was, is you know, and as I'm packaging it to them, I said to them, well, if we do Friday, Saturday, you're going to have to come to Plymouth on Thursday for weigh-ins for the Friday show. You're going to have to come Friday morning for weigh-ins for the Saturday show. You're going to have to come back Friday night for the fights, and then you're going to have to come back on Saturday night for the fights then. I go, what are we really arguing? Why are we spinning our tires? This should be a no-brainer. And here we are. And for me, being our 50th event, I mean, it's really special. This 50th event was supposed to be last year during COVID. And I'll be honest, I didn't know if we'd ever make it back doing live events through this COVID pandemic. And so it's really special to me that with such a monumental event, with what we went through over the past year and a half with the pandemic, you know, the community has really come out with open arms and welcoming the Cage Titans, you know, fighters and family and all that stuff. It's been tremendous. I mean, we've sold out both shows. The fighters are just so ecstatic to get back in there. Our first show back in July sold out in a record like 5 days. Mm-hmm. You know, we've never, you've been around the sport for a long time. Like most shows will sell tickets at the doors, and we've sold out before, but never 4 weeks before an event and only 5 days after the tickets have been on sale. So the community is hungry to get back out there and support their friends and family. And the community's been great. The fighters been great. I'm just excited to be celebrating. I thought when I fought, it was going to be one fight and never be involved in MMA again. And then one fight turned into two. Then I fought three times. Then I fought four times. Then it was like, all right, we're going to do an event as Cage Titans. And I did one event and then two. And then here we are 11 years later, 50 events in the bag. It's emotional for me because it's really changed the course of my life in the last 11 years. Look, and
I get a chill because I remember getting invited out to Coops. The first kickoff event was at Coops in Quincy. And I remember the place was packed. And you guys were like, wow, you guys were just kind of blown away at this attention because MMA was just really starting to take off. You know, it was starting to get approved in all these different states. And I remember going down to Coops that first night. And, you know, a lot of people who knew me from CageFX at that time, they were like, you know, this is keep an eye on these guys. And I've been watching you guys do your events, and you guys have been class acts also, doing good events. I was lucky enough to be able to do ring announcer for you one night, and it was a great time down there in Plymouth. And I've always said this, Plymouth Memorial Hall is the best place to see an MMA fight. And I know a lot of people like to be on the floor, and I'm usually cage side, I'm usually in the cage.
Yeah.
But I'm just telling people to be up in that upper level, just above the cage, for me, is the best seats in the house. I love mixed martial arts. I love the ground game. I've had people tell me, I hate watching mixed martial arts because I can't stand when it slows down and it's the ground game. And I had a guy sit with me, a Brockton cop, Frank Zanowski. He came with me. I said, look, trust and believe me. The ground game is where the strategy is. When we're sitting by the cage, watch the ground game. Watch the jiu-jitsu. Watch all of this other stuff. It's not about the upstanding. I says the battles that are really on the ground. And you could attest to that.
Yeah. You know, and it's funny because, like, you know, obviously there's a lot of talent in the art of stand-up and all that stuff, you know, as well. But, like, I can close – if you and I stood in front of each other, we can both close our eyes and swing our fists as hard as we can. And, you know, one of us is going to go down, whatever one connects first. You know, I said it – it's funny. I said it this weekend to my wife when we were talking about the fights that were going on in the UFC this past weekend. I was like, you don't really find a lucky submission. You know, you don't really get – that doesn't happen. You can catch a lucky punch. You can catch a lucky kick. The shin just happened. You know, the guy leaned into a knee or he, you know, he was leaning the wrong way and he got kicked. You know, you can catch some of those things that are lucky. You don't really catch a lucky guillotine. You don't catch a lucky armbar. You know, so there's a lot of skill and technique that is involved. So it's nice to hear that you do appreciate it, because, you know, the casual fan, they want to see the close their eyes slug in the center of the cage. But the beauty of some of the sport is that the other aspects of it, the cage work, the takedowns, and the sport as a whole.
And you've got Slippy Peter Barrett on this card. You got a lot of good fighters on this card. You've got the ladies on this card. And the funny thing is, look, I got to applaud you. I got to applaud all the independent MMA guys real quick, real personal MMA. Because to be honest, if it wasn't for you guys, the independent promoters, you guys wouldn't have made Dana White the biggest hypocrite in MMA, because he was adamant about not having women fight in MMA. And he admits this. He said if it wasn't for going out to the schools and the independent shows and seeing the amount of women fighting on cards such as Cage Titans or training in schools across America, and then starting to see that success come up through Strikeforce, he was never going to have women in the UFC. And now we have women because of promoters like you who took that chance and saw all these girls coming up through the schools. And I want you to kind of touch base on the women, because, you know, sometimes the women put on a good show. Sometimes they get the asses out the seats, man.
It's so funny you say that, because, like, it's so true. Like, oddly enough, the number one question I get when I'm like, oh yeah, when's your next show, Mike? Oh yeah, it's next weekend. Oh, you got any girl fights on the card? I'm like, actually, we do. And it's so funny. Like, how many woman fights you have? Oh yeah, two of them or three of them. It's like, oh cool. Well, I remember this one time the girls fought, and it was, and it, like, they just, like, I don't know what it is. Like, and it's an intriguing thing, because, you know, you follow a lot of sports, and I'm not saying that women's sports across the board aren't super popular, but, like, you know, you don't go to an NBA game and they're like, oh, like, is there a woman playing in this? Right, or, like, you know, the WNBA, you know, is not as popular. There's a reason that sometimes the women's sports aren't, whatever the reason is, I don't know, but there's a reason why that the women's sports aren't necessarily as popular as their male counterparts. And whether that's right or wrong, I'm not here to debate. I know that been debated, you know, in equal pay and the soccer teams and all that stuff, but it is what it is. For me, now being in sports with cage heads, I will hands down tell every male fighter who fights for me, the number one question I get is, how many women fights are on it? How many women fights are on this card? That's the number one question, and it blows me away. And you're right. A lot of the times, I don't know what it is about a woman fighting. Maybe it's the fact that you don't see it often, so it's more like intrigue. Whether the pure emotion, because sometimes I feel that women are, you know, they're not afraid to show emotions. You know, for a guy, fighting is, I'm a badass. And, you know, they don't show too much emotion. But women are more emotional by nature. And maybe because the pure, raw emotion, you can see it in their face more. You can see it in the lead up. And you can maybe connect to that maybe more. I don't know what it is. But you hit the nail on the head. You know, Dana was like, no way. But I tell you right now, there's a reason why that there's at least one woman fight on every main card the UFC has now. Years ago, that he said no.
Yeah, and I'm going to be honest, because before Ronda Rousey, before Gina Carano, the really only female athletes that I used to talk about know was Jenny Finch, the softball player, Flo Jo, the track runner. But now you start talking about professional female sports stars, everybody's going to just start rattling off female UFC stars, because that's it. And for a while there, 2 years ago, to be honest, 2 years ago, UFC was carried by the women's division about 2 years ago, because they had a ton of injuries in that men's division, a ton of real bad injuries to champs and stuff. And the women's, they carried it. We wouldn't have seen the Peñas and all of these ladies who are up there right now if it wasn't for that 2 years ago. So,
well, Ronda Rousey, like, you know when something's big, when the casual, and I say, you know, a casual fan will ask me when I say when the next show is, they'll ask, well, how many women fights? A casual fan, when you mention MMA, years ago, they would bring up Ronda Rousey. You know, you'd be like, oh, yeah, there's MMA. Oh, do you think you beat up Ronda Rousey? And it's like, well, you know, that was like the number one question you get as a male guy. And it's like, oh, do you think but casuals talked about him. The casuals talk about Conor McGregor now. Like, when you say MMA, they're like, oh, Conor McGregor? So I think the crossover appeal is kind of that. And I it's odd to say, but right now, you know, you were right. Women's fighting, Ronda Rousey kind of ushered it in. And now a lot of people are like, how many women are fighting? Ooh, I want to see that woman fight. And the casual fan is very much into it. And it's interesting. And it's good to see for female sports, you know. You know, there's so many other female sports, and maybe that women's MMA is so popular now that people will start looking and maybe the rise in popularity. Because once it rises in one sport, you'll see the trickle down to the other sports, and they will rise as well. So it could be great for all women's sports.
Now, before we let you get out of here and get ready to promote your event, I'm going to have you take your shoes off and put on the Dana White shoes of UFC, the Dana White shoes. Now, this is a real serious, question coming at you. You're probably going to have to think about it. You're in Dana White's shoes. You're the guy that controls what goes on. Well, he's not controlling, but he does have that say. He does have a lot of stuff that he's a big decision maker for the UFC. And you're going to put those shoes on right now. One of the biggest problems that I have with Dana White in the UFC is giving certain fighters third, fourth, and fifth chances. So we've got this situation here with John Jones. We've got this situation here with McGregor, where he's now assaulted three people, and now he's admitting to have this substance abuse with cocaine and stuff. When do you feel a promoter finally has to say, okay, I understand you put asses in the seat. I get it. You're putting money in my pocket. But when does the time come when the legal issues become so much that you got to say, because John Jones is done. His school already dumped him. As a promoter, when do you say enough is enough as a promoter?
Oh, man, it's so funny. When you first said you got to take off your shoes, I'm like, what kind of, like, is this a game we're playing? I almost jumped down and took off my shoes. But I literally, as you were spitting it out, I'm like, he wants me to take off my shoes? All right. But anyways, it's such a tough thing to say, you know, and it's a great question. I will tell you this. I've been in situations a few times locally, and I won't name names, but I had a fighter that I found out had some drug problems, and, you know, I was kind of oblivious to it, but some people pointed it out to me, and I basically said to him, all right, if you want to fight for me again, it's not mandatory, but I'm going to make you send me a clean drug test. If you want to fight for me your next show. And, you know, sadly, it kind of gets me sad thinking about it. He sent me a table full of drugs and says, "Now, good, I'm all set." And he never fought for me again. And, you know, I still check in on him. He seems to be doing okay. But, you know, every scenario is different. So I can't really, I don't know every scenario about Conor McGregor and John Jones. I know what I read in the media, but I've been put in difficult situations where I've had to say, yeah, I want this guy to fight for me, but I have some sort of obligation, higher obligation, than just throwing him in there because he's going to sell some tickets and make some money. Like, it's very, very difficult. And it's not even Dana White. You see it in all sports. I mean, you cover all sports. Yep, it happened right. In the NFL, you know, the Ray Rice issue years ago, that one sticks out to me. You know, Adrian Peterson, who supposedly hit his kid or whatever. You know, it's hard to say. I mean, there's three sides to every story, my side, your side, and the truth. So, how much of it is true? How much it is fabrication? How much of it lies in the middle? Every situation's unique. So it's hard for me to say, how would I judge? Because maybe Chuck Liddell, think about this. I don't know if you saw in the news. Chuck Liddell, it came out
just recently. Yeah,
three weeks ago.
Yep, he got an incident
But I don't know if the headline was Chuck Liddell got arrested for domestic violence. Domestic,
right.
Everybody was running. Oh, this is the third fighter with domestic violence. The follow-up story that probably didn't make as much headway was his wife assaulted him, and the cops, when they arrived to a domestic call, somebody has to go.
That's right.
They got to remove one of the parties. And Chuck said, I don't want you taking her, even though I was the one assaulted. I'm going to go.
That's right.
But guess what? The headlines that get spread was he hit her. And not many people are going to hear the follow-up that it wasn't when all the dust was settled. So I reserve judgment for some of these scenarios until all the details come out. And then I'm also very mindful that I may not know all the details ever in my life. So who am I to pass judgment? That question's only for Dana White. You know, has he talked to the police department? Has he talked to John's wife? When I was younger, I was in a situation with cops that a story, I got arrested and the story was embellished. And the next day I go to court and I'm like, they read the police report. And I'm like, that's not what happened. But the lawyer's like, listen, these cops show up to a scene and they don't know what happened because they weren't there. So they got to kind of put the pieces to the puzzle together and try to come up with some sort of semblance of what happened. Sometimes it's on, sometimes it's off. And so I've been subject to a situation that was blown out of control. And it was, so you asked a thought provoking question because it's tough, but I can tell you this, you know, if I'm in the situation and I know all the details, I'm not afraid to pull the trigger and do what needs to be done. You know, I gave you one example. I've been in another example where a fighter had a domestic and I basically told him, I said, until all the details come out, I'm not asking you to tell me right now, but until it settles the way it needs to settle and however that may be, I can't put you on a fight card until we get that straightened out. So, I can only give you my two experiences.
Right. And so for me, my thing is one of the reasons why it aggravates me is because there's always that fighter that's below that fighter in the rankings that always ends up getting screwed. Remember when John Jones was brought back, and I forget who was next up to have the next big fight, but because they brought Jones back, they pushed him down. And I forget who that fighter was. And it was the same thing with Conor McGregor. Conor McGregor decides, I'm going to come out of retirement. I'm coming back. And then I forget who was the number two or three at that time. That person got moved down. And I'm like, for those guys, that's who I'm thinking about. Because you're in the gym. You're sweating. You're going back and forth. You're spending 8, 10, 12 hours a day to get this shot. And then all of a sudden, guess who comes back? The golden egg comes back. And now, guess what? Dana's coming to you and saying, hey, I know I promised you this fight, but you're going to have to take a back seat because he's coming back. And now it's like,
I will
what
say
the
on,
hell?
On that note, like Connor and John specifically, you know, or, you know, any fighter or any person that has multiple scenarios, I'll just say as a blanket, take Connor's name or John, you're having that many scenarios around you happen. Mm-hmm. Maybe one's not true, or maybe one you get the benefit of the doubt.
Right.
Two, three, every damn month something's going on. It's like, all right, there's a track record here. You know, it's like I've had friends growing up. It's like, oh, I really didn't do anything this time. I'm like, yeah, but the cop remembers you from the five damn times that you did have something happen. Cool. The sixth time you really weren't doing anything, but maybe, you know, but what do you expect, man? Like with this smoke, this fire, like you have so many scenarios that are bad, so to speak, that are going around you, you're going to get lumped into that. And Dana, just like the NFL, he'll find, you know, the NFL kind of came up with their new policy when enough was enough and the public kind of kicked back. The only way that Dana's going to change it, Connor said it best. He said it on a tweet the other day. He goes, I'll stop acting the way I do when you stop buying my pay-per-views.
Ooh, so, see that? Yeah, and Steve Reeder, referee Steve Reeder, locally, and he's done UFC fights. He says it's all about who sells tickets.
And seats. And it's like Conor McGregor, is he going to stop his actions when all we do is just keep, you know,
that's
like,
right.
He knows, you know, Tito Ortiz way back in the day said it best. He goes, I want you to feel something about me. If you're indecisive on how you feel as me as a fighter, I didn't do my job. I want you to either hate my guts and want to see me get my ass kicked. I want you to love me to see me get, you know, beat. That's what Connor is. That's why people tune in. That's why Mayweather, they want to see him get his ass kicked. And there's other people that are like, I want to see this guy get to 51-0. Like, you need to make them care about you. And unfortunately, sometimes it's good actions that make them feel a certain way, and sometimes it's bad actions that make them feel a certain way.
You mentioned Mayweather. I lost a lot of respect for him for taking that Paul fight, man, and just making a mockery of the box. And that whole thing is a bad taste in my mouth, and I pray that MMA never gets to that friggin' point where we have to make our pay-per-view buys with a set of brothers who were famous on YouTube. And everybody's just collecting friggin' checks, man. I think it's just
horrible. Well, I mean, it's a weird way, but unfortunately, it's the world we live in today. Like these people who have 20 million followers for just opening, like my kids. I got five kids. My kids watch these other kids open presents all day. And I'm like, they have 20 million followers. They live in mansions because kids watch them open presents. I'm like, if you have an audience or you have a draw, then tell me if the Paul brothers started their own basketball team that they couldn't sell out an arena. They would. Like, they have followers. The way of the world nowadays is what your followers are, how many people you have on Twitter.
Yeah. It's insane.
You know, Keith, you've been doing this for a while, and like back in the day, they probably talked about how many website clicks you got, or how many distribution the newspaper. If you took a newspaper ad, it's like, what's the distribution? You do radio, it's like, well, what's your listener? Your listenership. Nowadays, it's like they don't care about any of that. How many followers you have on Twitter? How many Instagram followers you have? That's the currency right now.
Yeah, it's insane.
It's unfortunately the way the world goes. MMA, fun fact, I'm sure you remember it. We did one little crossover fight that I would say, well, we did the CM Punk fight in MMA, but whatever. But remember James Toney? He fought Randy Couture in Boston.
I was there for the fight. Yeah. That was the Joe Lozon fought on that card and pretty much almost packed the entire house with green shirts for that event.
Did he fight Gabe Rudiger?
That was a great fight, and I believe he took home maybe a submission or a fight night check that night too. I believe that night. Yeah. That was a good night. That was a good night, and I also believe that God rest his soul, police officers, Mr. Gannon was in attendance that night, who just recently passed away. But Mr. Gannon was in the attendance of that night, and we just lost him, MMA figure here in the Boston area. But man, it was a great talk with you, Steve Rita. Referee Steve Rita, thank you for being in the chat. A lot of people in the chat checking out the show. I got to let you shout out this event, man, and tell people how they can get tickets. I'm definitely going to be hitting you up. I want to cover this event for Hoobazoo, so I'll be coming down to check you out for that, man.
Absolutely. So, yeah, so, the fight's next Saturday night, Cage Titans 50. Our tagline's been a celebration so big we have to split into two. We got the day-night doubleheader. From 12 to 4 is the daytime event. It's all our local up-and-coming amateur prospects. We're doing MMA fights and Muay Thai during the day. And then we have a huge pro headliner for that day card. It's Zach DiSabatino, who's 7-2 right here out in Marshfield, Mass. And he's taking on Kentucky's Chance Beck, who's 5-1. The big note about this fight is that they're both finishes. I mean, Zach's 7-2. He has 6 first-round finishes. Chance Beck's 5-1. All 5 fights are finishes. And if you go back to their amateur days, Zach was 5-0 as an amateur, all finishes. Chance was 4-0 as a finisher, as an amateur, all finishes. So these guys come out swinging, they come out hot and heavy, and they rarely go to a decision. One decision between the two of them in their pro careers. So that fight should be a banger during the daytime card. And then we come back at night, 7:30. It's for the first time ever we're doing an all-pro card. We always do a pro-am event dating back to 2010, but this is going to be an all-pro card for the first time ever for us. In the headliner, Marty Navis, undefeated out of Lozon's, taking on Billy Goff down in Connecticut. Billy was the co-main event in our July card, and he took out Sean Lally, a huge upset victory for Goff. And Marty's been undefeated. They call him the Beast. That's his nickname. He's out of Lozon, training on there. They're both guys are trying to get to the UFC, and a win over the other is not only going to get them the Cage Titans welterweight title, but one step closer to maybe a phone call from the UFC. And then you've already mentioned a couple of them. Slippery Pete, Peter Barrett. He's going to be there fighting Hawaiian Spencer Higa. So we got a guy flying all the way in from Hawaii.
Nice.
Shameless Don Shanus. Shameless, everybody loves Shameless, Shameless Nation. He's fighting Quentin Weiland out of ATT out in Orlando. And we got all your favorites, Connor Matthews, Jeff Joy, Cam Arnold. The whole fight card is on CageTitansFC.com, so you can check them out there and also get your tickets.
Nice, nice, nice. Mike, I want to thank you for coming on the show here. What we're going to do here before I close out the show and get into my last bit of topics here, I want to thank him. I want to thank Michael Nunes for coming on with us. Gonna take a quick break. Guys, I got the trailer for Scream. The brand new Scream's coming out January 2022. As I said, this is my special Halloween show. I like to get this show out there every year. Unfortunately, Halloween isn't until like next Monday, and I didn't want to beat Halloween after the fact. So I want to thank you for coming on, Mike, hanging out with me. We're gonna take a quick break here. Steve Reeder, I see you in the chat. He said, great fight. Here it is. Here's the trailer for the brand new Scream 2022.
right, buddy. Well, thank you so much. I'm actually at Coop's right now. I've since bought. So it's from back in the day. I've since bought Coop's, and So my best friend owned it for years, and then over COVID, I was the manager here, and over COVID, he was like, "Listen, I'm closed. I'm not opening back up. If you want to buy it from me, cool. If not, I'm selling it." So I took over Coop's of June of last year. So. Yeah, you know, it's crazy. So it's had its ups and downs, and you know, it's fun because I was the manager here, and then I had Cage Titans, and when COVID hit, I had nothing. I had no Coops, I had no Cage Titans. So I was like, shit, I got to do something with my life. So there you are. Yeah, yeah, and are you in Brockton, right? Perfect. I'll see you next Saturday. Are you going to need internet and stuff? Are you going to do like a podcast or anything? Because you haven't been for a little while. So we have a back room where every fighter who wins, we bring them to a media room where everybody can kind of interview or ask questions. So I'll show you where that is. So if you need internet or anything like that, we have it all set up for you guys. All right. Good luck with the rest of the show. Later, brother. Have a good one. Thanks. Buddy.
Roddy, come on out from under there.
No!
Come on.
I saw a monster in the closet.
There is no such thing as monsters.
But I saw it.
Jeff, could you come up here?
Okay, pal, it's time for bed. There's no such thing as monsters.
It's your boy Sinister One broadcasting live from the City of Champions. I'm back here in the booth with you guys, and I gotta thank all my guests for coming on the show and hanging out with me and chatting. But I gotta blow through these topics because we got a lot of stuff that I gotta talk about real quick. And let's see here. The last thing I talked about was the debate, Councilor at Large debate, and ending the homelessness, which was going on. Show must go on. Snoop Dogg's mom passed away this weekend, and here's the thing about this one. Snoop Dogg's mom passed away. He had a show in Boston, and he could have easily canceled the show, but he decided to do the show. The show must go on, and then at the end of the show, he sang Stand By Me with the crowd that was involved with this show. Prayers and blessings go out to his family. Much support with him. And man, it's a tough one, but I gotta applaud him. Also in the news booth, Greyhound was acquired by Flix Mobility, FlixBus. You're gonna be seeing these FlixBuses around all over the place. They purchased Greyhound. Greyhound just settled a huge lawsuit for taking Border Patrol agents and doing illegal sweeps, and they lost. So they've got to pay out this settlement now in regards to this lawsuit. Also in the legal booth, Flavor Flav was arrested in Henderson on suspicion of domestic battery. As you guys know, Flavor Flav was the hype man for the rap group Public Enemy. Sad to see this. Don't know exactly what happened with the story, but you know what? I just hope this isn't something serious that's going to end up with him in jail for a long term. Also, Dr. Dre was served with divorce documents. I guess he owes money for her fees. And the constable served him at his grandmother's funeral in the parking lot. You might be getting knocked out. You serving me papers at my grandmother's, I might be a little bit upset, but if it was my mom or my dad, you get knocked out. You get knocked out. Simple as that. I'm just saying. I don't wish it on constables, but I know it's a tough job, but damn. Damn. Heading into the entertainment booth, Adrian Holmes, star of the upcoming Fresh Prince reboot, was involved in the fatal car accident in California. There was a man actually lying down on the highway, and he actually ran over and struck this man who was lying down on the interstate. I'm pretty sure hopefully he'll be cleared of all charges and he'll be able to go on with what he needs to do. But man, that's sad. That's a tough one. So I don't know. Rust armor Hannah Gutierrez Reed. She once gave an unchecked gun to an 11-year-old. For those who don't know who Hannah Reed is, if you're familiar with a lot of the action movies and stuff, her dad is Thel Reed. Thel Reed is a guy who is the guy who checks the guns, teaches the safety of the guns, and this and that. This Alec Baldwin tragedy is nepotism gone wrong. Hannah Reed had no knowledge or anything new. All she had was her name. She knew nothing about guns. There's several pictures of her not practicing. In this one, she's actually practicing trigger safety, but there are a lot of pictures out there of her on the set. she was on another set. They reported that she was loading guns while on the ground, and it was dirt. And anyone knows that if you're not paying attention, you can have pebbles or anything small get into the barrel. And when you go to shoot, you can have a misfire because the bullet can get lodged between the pebble that's now in the barrel and that bullet. If it can't get out because the pellet, you know, the its pellet is lodged in there, you can have a misfire in the chamber. You can have a misfire in the barrel, and somebody could get killed. Somebody could get hurt. In this case, the bullet could split, and the pieces of the bullet will go every other way because it's not going to go through hole and get the spin. It's going to come out and hit whoever's nearby. So this story here is nepotism at its worst. And, you know, it's sad to see that someone lost their life. Cinematographer Helena Hutchins lost her life in this tragic accident that could have been avoided. A lot of people out there who have gun knowledge, they can tell you right now that the steps were not followed. The steps were not followed. And the actors need to answer. The producer of the film is Alec Baldwin, who may have to still answer for this because you cut corners. You hire people who don't know their knowledge of weapons. Like I said, you know, this was only her second film handling firearms on set. When I heard this story, I was taken back to Brandon Lee on the set of Crow. Someone loaded the wrong squib into the firearm. People don't realize this. There's different types of firearm ammo when you're on a movie set. You have ammo that needs to simulate, you know, that needs to simulate actual fire. Baldwin owns a piece for not checking his firearm. And I thought the same thing, Mr. Tom McGinty in the chat. I thought the same thing. When someone, in the first rule of when you get your firearm license is that if anybody hands you a firearm, you check it. You always check it. Again, Alec Baldwin, yeah, he does own a piece of this. He should have checked that firearm when it was handed to him. But if it was handed to him by his armorer, who told him that the firearm was all set. And if he doesn't have that knowledge, like I seen Keanu Reeves. Keanu Reeves makes sure he does proper training. Keanu Reeves is a licensed firearm owner. He wants that knowledge. So when he's firing firearms in John Wick and all these movies, he wants to know what he's hearing. But again, some people, actors and actresses, they're there just to shoot the film. They don't care about those. I think maybe, to be honest, you make a good point, Tom. Maybe anybody who's in an action movie or anybody who's in any type of film where they're going to handle guns, I think they should have to pass a licensed course in firearms. I think Hollywood should make that mandatory. And if that's the case, if anybody who's going to be handling firearms on the set of a film, they're going to know. If you're handed a firearm, you're going to check that firearm. Yeah, it's going to add a little bit of time to your shooting times of your film, but at least you're not going to have these tragedies like this happen. It's just a sad... Anybody who has a license or anybody who's done any type of training, I'm pretty sure that this story right here, I'm pretty sure that anybody who's going for a license to carry, that their gun trainer or whoever's training you for your class to get certified, this story is going to come up. This is a recent story. This story is going to come up in probably every license to carry class across the nation as of this week. I'm pretty sure of it because this could have definitely have been avoided. Also, heading into the sports booth, rest in peace, Newmy, Bob Neumeyer. I was able to meet him at several of the hot stove events here in Brockton. Tom McGinty said, I don't buy that. He said, I had the police chief here today, clear the piece, handed it to him, and guess what he did? He handed it back to me, and guess what I did? Yeah, exactly. That's the first thing they tell you. Clear your pieces. Let them know. Never trust any firearm that's handed to you, period. Even if you look at it. We've seen it. When I was going to class for training, I saw a video where a police officer shot himself in the leg in a pawn shop. Because they took it out the case. The gun store owner handed it to him to look at. And he's looking it over and points it down and boom, shoots himself in the leg. Obviously, the pawn shop took the firearm in. They probably never checked the firearm before the pawn person. And look, I've seen it. It's been fast and furious in the gun stores with people pawning stuff and consigning stuff at the gun shops. It's been crazy. It's fast and furious, but hey, you got to take that time to stop and check. So yeah, I go with you, Tom. Bob Neumeyer, Newmy, passed away 70 years old. Horse racing expert. He died at 70 years old. Congestive heart failure. He was in hospice for like 6 or 7 weeks, I think they said. So sad stuff. And my prayers and blessings go to him. Patriots, get it right. Patriots, 54-13 over the Jets, pick up their first home game. A lot of people saying, yeah, but it's the Jets. Yeah, but you know what, people? It's not easy to drop 50 points on any team. I've had people out there. I have my godson, Kevin. He's like, well, my son could beat the Jets. No, they can't. You can be sarcastic, okay? You can be sarcastic and say that when you're talking to them, but let's be realistic here. No, your kid's team can't beat the Jets. No, Brockton High can't beat the Jets. It's a grown-ass men professional football team. High school teams and Pop 1 teams aren't beating the Jets. It's not easy to drop 50 points on any team in the NFL on any given day. 50 points is a lot of points. I don't care how bad your team is. 50 points is a lot to score. So here's the deal, people. And a lot of people are coming at me and saying that they're still a crappy team. They're not that crappy of a team, people. They're not that crappy a team. And guess what? The AFC East is not really out of the realm of reach for this team. Two of the losses came from NFC teams, Dallas and Tampa Bay. So you've got two NFC losses that you have. They still have two games against Buffalo. They've now swept the Jets. They'll split with Miami like they always do. I'm pretty sure of it. They're going to split with Miami. And then you have two games against Buffalo, pretty much back-to-back. You got one game against Buffalo, then they're away, and then they come back and play Buffalo again. That three-game stretch could decide the AFC East, to be honest, depending where they are record-wise. So, again, playoffs is not out the realm, people. So pay attention. Stop selling this team short. Biden bombshells as we get ready to close out the show. Biden and Harris, the honeymoon looks like it's over. His voter support is Oh, Terrell Hayes, my son, Terrell is in the chat. He says they're going to get swept by Buffalo. I don't want to start anything because I love my son dearly. I love my son for the next. I love my son till Saturday. Come Sunday, Halloween Sunday. I don't love my son for that day because the Patriots will be playing his team, the Chargers, the Los Angeles Chargers, out there at SoFi Stadium, which I would love to have gone to and taken him to, but my son don't fly. I would have loved to have put that money up because I was able to take my son to see the Eagles play in Philly, my oldest. And as a dad, if I was able to take my other son to see the Chargers play at SoFi Stadium, that would have just been the ultimate dad thing, to take both your boys to see your team play their teams in the same year. That's awesome. Terrell Hayes says, the Bills have always had our number. You're right. You're right. Buffalo Bills have always come in and smacked this team around. But they're kind of letting the reins off. Guys are coming back. Wow. Terrell said, y'all going to smoke us as usual. Bill has their number. Oh, I was hearing him wrong. My son is actually saying the Patriots are going out to L.A. and going to probably beat the Chargers. This is coming right from my son, huge Chargers fan. I'm not looking past the Chargers. I'm not looking past the Chargers. And you may say Bill Belichick has had that team's number, but they don't have Tom Brady. Mac Jones is a good quarterback. He's still learning. He's still coming out of his shell. Josh McDaniels is the key to this game. If he keeps improvising and opening up this playbook and doing things like he's been doing the last few weeks and not holding back, there's a good chance they could go in there and win this game. But it's going to be a good game. I'm going to be happy to watch this. I'm going to be happy to see this. And if the Patriots do beat the Chargers, then they're going to be over 500. And they're going to have a good record heading into this next stretch, that they've got some very winnable games. Very winnable games. So we'll see. As I was saying in the Biden bombshells, Biden and Harris appearances have plummeted. You don't see these guys pretty much together because the word is that she's not happy with his status with the polls. And we'll see. We will see what happens here. We will keep an eye on this. A lot of people aren't happy with the job that Biden's doing. I was ripping Biden apart for the last 2 weeks because they were putting out lies in regards to the spin on the numbers, the unemployment numbers, the sale numbers, and all that crap. You know, they were putting that illegal spin, that lie out there that it's him, and it's not. It's because COVID is opening. COVID's dying down. A lot of people going back to work. So we'll see. Unemployment's going to go back up, though, because we got a lot of people quitting their jobs because of they don't want to take the vax. So we'll see what happens there. Guys, my beanies are available. I don't have many left. I got to actually put in an order. Hopefully, I'll get some in before the winter. But I got to thank everybody who's been buying the beanies and supporting me. Great stuff here and there. Also, check out the podcast, Oscar Mike Radio, Maddie C Sports for You and Me. Happy Hour with Lito. Talk Back with Gloria Shea. Who I saw Maddie. Maddie was actually in the chat. So, Maddie, thanks for hanging out, tuning in to the show with us. And again, Cage Titans 50 is coming up next weekend. Doubleheader down in Plymouth at Memorial Hall. Mike, Polvere, thank you for coming on the show, hanging out with me tonight. Good stuff. My son just said, no beanies, go hoodies. You know what? I got a lot of women in my chat about the hoodies. So, maybe I'll go with hoodies this winter. Maybe I will go with the Sinister One beanies and for next year and do hoodies for this year. Operation Hope on the home front. I'm going to be DJing this event on November 20th. It's to raise awareness for PTSD. And I think it's like $20 a ticket, $22 a ticket for a good cause. Make sure to come on out. And that's the show, ladies and gentlemen. Again, Vian Marie's music available on all music streaming outlets. And I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Councilor at Large candidate Michael Nunes came on the show. Election is actually next week, November 2nd. We got to get out there and vote. I see Tito out there. I seen Keith was out there. Gary Keith Sr., he was out there. And I think that's about it. I think I got to get ready to get out of here and get some food. And SpongeBob, do me a favor. Can you take us home?
Well, see you next Tuesday. Thank you for listening to The Booth on Hoobazoo and HatcherRadio.com. Please follow the Facebook page and subscribe to the podcast at Apple Podcast, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. The Booth is a Sinister One production hosted by Sinister One.
I've got to start hanging out with friends that are a little more intelligent and understand politics and stuff. It's just that I'm up on this level up here, and all my friends are down here. Me, nah. You guys, meh. Maybe a little more down in here. Screw you guys, I'm going home.
I smoke, I drink, I do my thing. These bitches hating, so you know I got to make it plain. Don't do cocaine with your chick, my main. We stick together, true forever, yeah, you know we bang. I miss those days, which was easy. If only I make it, bitch, don't repeat. Now that I done upgraded, I've been upstate, and y'all think I'm playing. And I got a hit now for these weak ass hoes who think I ain't slaying. Try me, and I'll probably end up laughing, cause I never back down. I'm that chick with a clean ass whip, I don't need that shit, cause I got my own now. I get hurt, I get tired of fussing, fighting, guess I gotta crack down. Don't mess with me, cause on everything, I'ma have to bring the whole city out.
WHOOBAZOO at Hoobazoo.com.
Enter your website.